Good morning, everyone. A very warm welcome to all of you. We all know how hard it is to build a brand in India. The rate of success is quite low, and our panel here is to discuss how companies cope with such emerging challenges. This is also an interesting time as we're just coming out of a pandemic, which has brought with it its own set of opportunities and challenges. So our panel today, as Shaleen mentioned, will discuss how to fight brand fatigue, expand to new categories, how to retain customer loyalty, and most of all, how to achieve scale. So let me introduce our panel and welcome our panel. We have with us Mr. Sanjay Singhal, who is the Chief Operating Officer of the Dairy and Beverages Business at ITC. At ITC, Sanjay has led the company's entry into the dairy category, with the launch of fresh dairy and dairy beverage businesses. Our second panelist is Anoop Bector from the founding family of Mrs. Bector Specialities, which has been making bread and biscuits for over 25 years. As many of you know, he's just coming off a very successful IPO launch last month. We also have with us Mr. Ravi Saxena, managing director of founder and managing director of Wonder Chef Appliances, a brand which has scaled to well over 500 crore in revenue in the last 10, 11 years, in a very short period. A very warm welcome to all of you. I hope we have a fruitful and productive discussion today. Let me start with you, Ravi. Can you tell us what your experience has been over the last decade in launching and scaling your brand?
Yeah, thank you, Ranjini, and such a pleasure to be on this August summit with my fellow speakers, and a warm welcome to everybody who is watching us. Well, over the last 10 years, I think for our industry, which is cooking at home, I think everything has changed.
Right.
So I remember 10 years ago, I was on a flight to Europe trying to understand what I should do, what is the European style, what is European quality that I wanted to bring to India in the Indian kitchens. And I met a classmate of mine, and he's a very successful investor. And he said, Ravi, I am investing in restaurants. So while you are betting on cooking at home, I am betting on cooking out, on eating outside home. So who is going to win 10 years down the line?
Yeah.
And I told him that, look, cooking is never going to go out of fashion in India because we love our home food and we really belong there. So in the beginning, we found it difficult because people were used to slightly lower standards in the kitchen. The nonstick cookware, etc., were of a quality that, you know, it used to come off. The blenders and mixers were old style. But I'm very happy today to say that we have been able to change everything. We have been able to upgrade the quality. People are experimenting with new things, and especially the pandemic. It has just revolutionized because, you know, everybody who probably even never went inside a kitchen earlier has become a part-time chef. Right. People are cooking recipes, they're baking, they're clicking photographs, and they're posting these photographs in different circles. So I think kitchen has somewhere entered the heart really now.
Right. Anoop, I'll just come to you, but Sanjay, I can see you nodding. What has been your experience over the last, you know, from an ITC perspective? You will bring a conglomerate perspective for all of us. What has been your experience, and how did the pandemic change things for you all?
Okay, so good morning to everyone and to my fellow panelists, and thanks to VC Circle. So I think that obviously, I represent an organization which has practically built a decently large foods business in the last 15 to 20 years. And all these brands have been built, and the business have been built from the ground up. These are all Indian brands which have been built, just like I think from Mr. Saxena and Mr. Bector. So I think that ties all the three panelists together, if I may venture out and say that. And obviously, it's not easy because, I've worked in multinationals before, FMCG companies. And obviously, when you have a playbook which you need to just tinker around a bit and then execute in a country, it's much easier. But when you're launching a new business, it is about understanding the current value curve and the current supply chain equations, then trying to do some innovation on that. So that has been the first critical thing. And honestly speaking, I mean, everything is not rosy. I mean, even if I look at our biggest brand of ITs, which is Ashirwad Atta, which is our pride. There were significant learnings the first few years. Yeah. As there are in any businesses that you create in any sector in the country. Now, having said that, I think the critical thing is resilience. The critical thing, which all entrepreneurs, and I'm blessed with many entrepreneurs in the panel. I think that the critical thing is you have to be resilient. Right. But you also have to have attention to detail. Because often startups or new businesses in our organization, they don't do well because the significant attention to detail has not been given to the basic understanding of the economics, the consumer insights, the retail or the trade landscape, and the go-to-market strategy, and the financials from every angle of supply chain in the category. So when you crack that, and sometimes you have to change your strategies midway, you're able to reach there. And we are seeing that live in every part of our business right now. Now, coming to the pandemic, I want to echo Mr. Saxena's point, because obviously, I mean, we all know there have been ad nauseum discussions in terms of pantry loading, et cetera, et cetera. But I want to just take on from Mr. Saxena, because, you know, we saw the same thing. I mean, it was crazy. I mean, atta was not available. From us, a lot of ingredients that Mr. Saxena talks about, which were used by on his appliances by the consumers to make cakes or to make other stuff, were simply not available. And what I want to share is that just Mr. Saxena talked about creating the home chefs. Hmm. I mean, what we also did, very interesting, and we are repeating that again, is that, you know, while we are a food company, we are also a hotel company.
Right.
And we are known and we pride ourselves in the quality of food of ITC restaurants. And I'm sure all of you have graced our hotels for that. And what we did in the pandemic, very interestingly, is that we said that consumers, as Saxena Saab said, are sitting at their homes.
Right.
And they're not able to go out and enjoy quality restaurant or hotel type food. So we actually made our chefs, we shot them in their own kitchens, how to use home-based ingredients that they have.
Right.
The sort of fantastic equipment that Mr. Saxena's company sells. And bring out restaurant quality food in their homes so that they can enjoy a good evening out or a weekend out in with their families.
It
was called ITC MasterChef. And you know, these are things which we find very interesting. Hmm. And these are things we deployed in digital, like was talked about earlier.
Anup, I now come to you. At the time of the IPO, your brand had scaled up to over 700 crore. Can you tell us, your experience in scaling your brand, and at what point was the inflection? What was the inflection point for Mrs. Bectors? How did you all achieve it? And also some thoughts from, the last year. How did you all cope with the supply chain challenges, and what were the constraints, and how did you all cope with that, basically?
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, VC Circle, and thank you, Ranjini, for for us to be here today. In fact, for any FMCG company, it's a very tough business. It's extremely tough because we are, competing with very, very large multinationals or large Indian conglomerates. So journey is extremely difficult when you are talking about a market which is a biscuits 45,000 crore market, and breads, which has been considered as a commodity in India till now, and changing fast. But for us, the journey initially has been very tough because other than the acceptance from the customer for a new brand, it is the acceptance of the retailer, of the, of the wholesalers, which is not there because his shelf space is limited. Earlier, the shops were small. Today, the shops are large and so many more products are available for them. And, they would like to keep products where they really don't want to put in their effort. So as my journey started, we started extremely small in this business, and we expanded as we learned. So we did not have the money from an investment banker, which was there that we could really, play around with. So it was extremely small money. banks were very skeptical on giving us money at that time, because FMCG success rate in FMCG, you know, ventures is very, very limited. Now, when we started, we were actually selling mass products. So we were more into glucose biscuits, more into 5 rupee segments, 3 rupee segment. And while the journey continued, we kept, you know, getting into the market, kept increasing our distribution. You know, we are today available in around 5 lakh outlets in North India, you know, and going forward, we are looking at doubling these numbers in probably another 2 to 3 years, and also expanding into Pan India. But what has happened today is that we are today one of the, you know, as a manufacturer, I have more premium products. We have stopped our very limited supply of glucose biscuits. Mass products is continuously being reduced, and more focus is being given on premium products. Premium products, not premium what the Indian market is calling it. You know, because we have a different perspective about premiumization, which companies have tried to create. But this is more like what Ravi said. Even, you know, while in Europe, he was able to see what is different. What are people doing differently? We did the same. We traveled a lot, because our company today exports to around 60 countries. We had a lot of exposure. We were the first company to bring in investments which were nobody had brought in India. Not even the largest companies had brought in, you know, those investments. We brought in completely European lines. And we gave customers a different product, a new product. And that allowed the retail to, you know, give us shelf space, the respectability of the product. And today, you know, that has been the reason that the company has been growing well. In the last year, our company, you know, has grown by double digits. And, you know, our shareholders really, you know, reacted to the company's strengths, which have been there. And the pain points will keep continuing. Pain points are not only for smaller companies. Pain points are for larger companies, bigger pain points for larger companies. Because, you know, price points, raw material prices, and you have always to be in profit. You can never lose money. So, right. You know, you have to keep continuing fighting a very heavy competition. And, you know, on the brand loyalty side, I think people are loyal to large brands, but they are open to newer products, newer brands. And we see a lot of success coming in out of smaller companies who have given new innovative products to, you know, the customers.
Right.
So
right.
I strongly feel, you know, for smaller companies to grow, you know, newer products, new innovations have to be brought in to the market.
Right. Thank you. You know, given the pandemic last year, and all of you mentioned the importance of technology and digital, having an important digital strategy. So, you know, I wanted to get some sense from you on how much do you spend on your digital and technology strategy? What is the capex allocation that you all think brands have to make now to sort of survive in this new normal? May I start with you, Sanjay, for this?
Okay, so see, I mean, obviously, digital is two parts, right? One is that how do you enable efficiencies
right. Of
an organization in terms of supply chain, product development, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
That is where your query on CapEx will come in, because, right. And CapEx typically is deployed in something like SAP right. Or in hardware, et cetera, et cetera. So to that extent, as Mr. Bector talked about, that India is the land of Kirana outlets. Mm-hmm. And because we have confectionery and all, we reach out to, let's say, 45 lakh outlets or something.
Right.
So obviously, one of the large investments we have done a few years back, like right. Any other FMCG companies, that we have given handheld devices right. To all our salesmen.
Right.
So, I mean, beyond the ITC salespeople, obviously, distributors have thousands of salesmen
right. For
our tobacco or for our food products or personal care.
Right.
And each of them has been enabled with not only let's say a device where when he's walking into one of the 25 shops or 30 shops, he's supposed to go. He knows that what is the products he has, what are the schemes they're running, what are the offers, what is the last few purchases of this retailer. And also it is enabled by a backend AI, which actually generates that this outlet, what should be the recommended order? Because obviously there's very high turnover at the front end. Talking about somebody who earns 10,000, 15,000 rupees and is going and selling and deciding the fate of your brands like biscuits or atta or juices or noodles. So that is one part of it. The second part, it doesn't require capex, obviously, the front end part, which is the e-commerce part, or let us say the digital marketing part. And that is something which I think that, as one of your colleagues was talking about, has obviously for all of us taken a huge increase. And I mean, I'm also what has happened is that just like TV, when the 1980s, when TV started out, nobody understood TV advertising. Now marketeers across the country have begun to understand what digital marketing is all about. And slowly, slowly, I'm seeing that more of our money, as a percentage of our ad spends, are going into digital marketing or e-commerce marketing.
Interesting. Anup, can I bring you in here on this? What has been, how has your technology spend on digital and technology shifted over the last few years?
So, as Sanjay mentioned, you know, I mean, on handheld tools, sales automation, you know, this has been the biggest benefit which could have come to a company which has got a large distribution. And I strongly feel that the distribution which India has, the number of shops which a company can cover, you know, a million, or like what Sanjay said, they do around 45 lakh shops, you know, we never had control on the efficiency of these people. There are thousands of people working at the market. And today, I mean, we can track our people, what is their efficiency, schemes go online, we know if a person has to do 30 shops or 40 shops, what is the success ratio, what are our focus products, you know, and what is the product which the company wants to sell. And also on the AI side, you know, where the intelligence on what should be the potential order which should be coming in from a particular retailer, special focused retailers, which, because every town or city has special retailers, you know, who are going to be, who are very important, you know, to the company. And so today, I mean, we have a handheld tool, which we call it as Perry, and it is working extremely well. In fact, when the COVID started, we had information around 200,000 outlets directly with their telephone numbers, with their orders, with the, and we could connect to them within a day.
Right.
All of our team connected to them within a day. And our company, you know, in the first quarter grew by, I think, 30-40%. You know, that was the sort of connect the supply chain our team could have had, you know, had have. And this is also, you know, linked to SAP. So once it is linked to SAP, we are getting real-time information for everyone, and policies can change. Competition, what is competition benchmarking happening? What is competition doing in the market? So all this information was there with us. So, you know, I think very, very similar. Today, for a smaller company to be successful, it is very important that efficiencies of its people who are working in the market needs to be measured. If that is measured and there is a success over there, you know, the success ratio for a company can be much better. Right. And on the advertising side, like Sanjay mentioned, you know, I think for digitalization is very important. On our bread side, we have been doing advertising. We have been making small videos on how people can make sub sandwiches, you know, breads which they were eating out of Subways, they could bake at home. So a lot of new products got launched, and has actually delivered better success than the conventional advertising. So I think digitalization, both on the operation front and on the marketing front, will need substantial budgets, you know, to for any company to move forward.
Succeed, yeah. Ravi, to you, I wanted to understand your company's digital strategy as well. And something that Anup mentioned just now, about smaller companies, do you feel it's easier for companies now to break through and reach a critical mass because of the power of technology?
Yeah, I will give a slightly different insight into the technology affair. Sanjay represents ITC, which has been around forever for generations and has done a brilliant job in establishing distribution. Anoop's firm has been around for some time and has created a very impressive distribution across North India with 5 lakh outlets. And, you know, this was the challenge for the entry of new brands in India. As you earlier said, that it was very difficult for brands to establish themselves in India, primarily because of distribution, because lacks of outlets and whatnot, unorganized people, no tracking of data. So I was a man in a hurry. You know, I didn't want to wait for this long. I was not trying to build a company for the next generation. I wanted to see it here and now. And the only way I could have done it is by flattening the distribution curve. Because otherwise it can take a company 30 to 40 years to establish itself across India in terms of distribution. You need to win the people's faith at every single outlet. Mm-hmm. And it takes time. It takes a lot of money. So what we did was we utilized digitization to flatten this curve and to be able to compete with the largest of players who have been around for 40, 50, 60, 70 years. Mm-hmm. And, you know, bloody their nose, if I may say. And we have been able to do that thanks to the digital approach. So yes, we have also invested in Salesforce automation, and that helps our general trade business. But I think we have done much more. And I also believe that our category, with the higher average order values, and hence the ability to spend higher on acquisition of each customer, also somewhere allows that. So today, we have managed to convert almost 40% of our sale to digital sale. And while my own distribution, and remember, these are durables versus consumables. Right. So consumables have lakhs of outlet, even a Pan BD outlet can sell a biscuit packet. So for us, the typical distribution network, which is relevant to us across India, is 1 lakh shops. And we are there in about 14,000-15,000 out of them.
Okay.
Over the last 10 years. That's what it takes. But, and we cover only about 500 pin codes with the shops that we are in. But through digital presence, I am able to cover 12,000 pin codes. And I think that is the real difference. 500 versus 12,000. And no surprises that 40% of my sale is through digital medium. So in terms of investment of technology, you asked a very pertinent question. So we have gone beyond Salesforce automation. We have invested a lot in backend at every step. But more importantly, we are investing a lot in customer acquisition on Google, on Facebook, on Instagram. If you see our Instagram properties, they're very exciting. We have lakhs and lakhs of followers, over 1 million followers on Facebook, which for a relatively young brand is pretty impressive. But that is what is allowing us to win this digital war. And yes, we also work with the e-commerce giants like Amazon and Flipkart and Big Basket and Paytm, everybody. We also spend money. We also invest in brand building on these platforms. They have their own platforms for earning our money, for, taking our money. But I think the returns are good. That is typically called in-channel marketing. Right. So the results in-channel marketing are quite good because the customer is going there with an intent to buy. So there, if you are able to spend some money, the results can be far better. So yes, we have really enjoyed investing in technology on both ends, CapEx and revenue.
Right. Now I come to the next point. You know, with so many companies investing in technology, everyone has a digital strategy. How do you, you know, differentiate yourself from other brands? And how do you, you know, actually the question, how do you fight brand fatigue and keep your brand fresh for consumers, you know, and to keep it relevant in the market? Do you have thoughts on that? Sanjay, do you want to take that?
Okay, so I'm saying that the first thing, whatever I have learned over the last few years, is that marketeers get bored and get fatigued by their brands more than consumers do.
Ah, okay.
The biggest problem in marketing globally. Okay, and I can see Mr. Ravi Saxena nodding on. Mm-hmm. That is the first thing. The second thing is that I think that brand fatigue will happen if the marketeer or the entrepreneur does not have imagination. Mm-hmm. I am saying that it is up to us how we can create and refresh our brands while being true to what the brand stands for and why that brand is, let's say, valued by the consumer. So I'll give you an example. Again, I'll go back and take your audience back to Ashirwad Atta, which is the leader or whatever, and which has practically created the packaged Atta market in this country and a very high quality product. Now, obviously, I mean, just to take that, the first few years of Ashirwad Atta was all about moving the consumer and communicating why he should, she should move from a chakki atta, chakki ka pisa hua atta, which is a habit in the west and north of India, to a packaged atta.
Right.
So you were, the communication and the activation and the messaging you were doing was all about saying ki MP packaging, jaise ghar mein pista hai, waise vagara vagara. But now with the digital and the need to refresh, all the discourse has now moved on to communicating to a South Indian consumer and why he or she should move, or an East Indian consumer, why she should move from a rice-based meal in the morning at breakfast or during lunchtime to an atta-based meal.
Right.
So that, because it's a healthier habit. And that has meant digital communication. I'm segueing into digital from your question now, into stuff like bachon ko lunch box mein, when kids were going to school, कैसे आप रोटी के अंदर जैम लगा सकते हो, ब्रेड लगा सकते हो, मतलब हाउ यू कैन मेक ब्यूटीफुल स्नैक्स. तो आई मीन डिजिटल इज एक्चुअली अ फंटास्टिकली लिबरेटिंग मीडियम फॉर ब्रांड्स टू कम्युनिकेट देयर मल्टीपल डिमेंशन, बिकॉज अदरवाइज आई एम सेइंग दैट एनी ब्रांड कैन ओनली कम्युनिकेट वन डिमेंशन ऑफ देयर पर्सनैलिटी, वन डिमेंशन ऑफ देयर यूसेज. बट डिजिटल गिव्स दैट पावर, एज माई अदर कलीग्स वर टॉकिंग अबाउट हियर, टू एक्चुअली कम्युनिकेट the multidimensionality of their offerings from an emotional, functional, usage, etc., etc. dimensions, I would say.
Right. Ravi, do you have that challenge, and are you able to add to what Sanjay is saying?
I think the consumer habits have also changed. Two examples: consumers have stopped reading; they are consuming content by watching. And second, they get fatigued very quickly, not with the product, but with the approach to them. So if you repeat an ad too much, earlier, you know, we used to have one ad, successful ad running for years and years. Today, because there is just so much content available on the fingertips, the consumer has gotten fatigued very quickly. So you need to keep up coming with new things, which digital allows you to do. It allows you to specifically target the people who are responding to your advertisement. And moreover, it allows you hacky approach. You know, earlier there used to be 10-minute videos, then there used to be 2-minute videos, then 1-minute videos. Today, anything which is beyond 10 or 15 seconds, you have lost the consumer. So I think digital allows you all those testings, it allows you all those experimentation, and enables you to keep refining your approach and keep finding your consumer. Moreover, you can also launch very specific products. You know, earlier, if you wanted to launch a product, how do you reach it out to the consumer? Unless it is relevant for the masses, you cannot advertise. So it was a catch-22. Today, we have been able to launch products which are costing 15,000, 20,000 rupees. We know only 0.1% of Indians will buy that. But today, thanks to digital, I can reach that 0.1% audience very efficiently. I can spend 1,000 rupees on the customer acquisition, and yet my cost of sales, or advertising cost of sales, as they call it in digital medium, ACoS, will only be 5%, which is reasonable. And I can make a good margin with a 20,000 rupee product and spending 1,000 rupee on reaching out to that 0.1% consumer. So I think as we speak, we are still discovering the power of the digital medium, but the possibilities are immense and we are co-creating them. Earlier, we used to be dependent on what a Doordarshan would give to us, and then what a Sony or Zee would allow to us. Thanks to digital, we are creating. We are creating the mechanisms.
Anup, I want your thoughts on, customer fatigue with a brand, and, how do you retain customer loyalty with so many brands now in the market?
Yep. So I strongly believe, that the companies are responsible for customer fatigue. They do not change, they do not, they're very happy with what they're doing. They do not work, backwards to see on innovation, on technology, on things where the changing customers' needs are met. So today's customers' needs are much more than what it was about, basic commodities. Today they are looking at taste, they're looking at profile. Their taste profiles are changing from chaat masala to some Italian flavors. You know, you see the success we have received from for pizzas, moved out. I mean, pizza flavor is today available in chips and in any snacking commodity. You know, this is a changing need of the customer. If people are going to just move into their own thought process, you know, with what they have been selling for 20 years. I mean, let me take a case of a Marie biscuit. I mean, a Marie biscuit has been selling for more than 30 years. People are actually grown old with it and they need to change.
Yeah.
We need to give a better, healthier option, a more tastier option, which is also giving the health and the needs of the today's customer.
Yeah.
So our customers are more aware, and our company is a younger company. We are more, aligned, or our teams are more aligned towards giving newer innovations. And that is very, very important. So today, no packaging stays for more than 5 years. No product should stay more than 5 years. The product has to innovate. I mean, we have some butter cookies or something like, which has been going for 20 years. People in the rural, now those sales are happening more in the rural side. As and as digitalization is going to move into the rural side, like what was earlier mentioned, you know, people are going to change. I mean, today to reach to a billion or a million customers through digitalization is so easy. I mean, it is not something that you have to make your product reach each and every outlet. So I think innovation to the needs of the customer is important, and brand product fatigue will keep happening, but that will give us a new innovation to create a new product, a bigger market, you know, going forward. So
right.
I strongly feel that along with product fatigue, you know, companies have to change over, bring in newer products, you know, and sales will keep happening.
Right. I also want to have your thoughts on, you know, acquiring other companies as a way to keep the brand fresh. Does it make sense when you all have an existing brand to look at acquisitions to add allied categories? And does that work in your experience? Sanjay, may I bring you in for that?
Yeah, I mean, the first thing is obviously that it is much more difficult to create a new brand than to create a sub-brand.
Right.
So, for example, because media and Mr. Bector in the beginning talked about the distribution challenge.
Right.
Now, even for a company like ITC, when we launch a new brand and we put in, it takes a lot of money and effort to do, the retailer is much better. For example, when we wanted to enter the fresh dairy business and launch basic stuff like pouch milk, curd, paneer, lassi, etc. In the east of India, we could have launched a new brand. But when we went with Ashirwad, because the retailer and the consumer knew what Ashirwad was, there was no problem, because A, the equity of Ashirwad is about trust and purity of ingredients, which is what milk and trust in milk is also the same thing. Number two, the retailer knows Ashirwad. So even if ITC had gone with, let's say, XYZ brand, I think the success or whatever success, whatever reception we got would have been significantly lower. So I think that, yes, building new businesses is difficult, but synergies are very important. And it's not easy, because in Unilever, they have a term called, when you launch a new brand or a new business, treat it with the LTC. What is LTC? Love and tender care.
Yeah.
The love and tender care needs to happen across the organization. Because creating a new business is like bringing up a child. It takes years, and I'm seeing some of the entrepreneurs in this session here will be able to talk about that, because an entrepreneur really lives and dies for his brand.
And
I think that is what it is all about.
Ravi, do you have thoughts on adding product categories via acquisitions? Does it make sense?
Look, along the way, I've been working now and leading companies for the last 25 years. I have always found that organic growth is more profitable than inorganic growth. Having said that, one is never close to the idea, because especially in today's world, the brands which are coming out digitally, and I'm speaking in context of digital, because that is the focus of this program. Sometimes for larger organizations, it becomes difficult to, turn on a coin, and they are not able to move that fast. While the younger players, the young entrepreneurs, they are able to create digital brands almost overnight. It seems overnight. It yeah. takes 2 to 3 years, but that is like overnight in a big company's lifetime.
Yeah.
They create access to consumers, they create new tech, and that is something large organizations, for the kind of frameworks they work with, nothing wrong with that, they are not able to do. So I think for large organizations, it's very interesting and it's very effective strategy to acquire smaller, nimble new players, learn what they are doing, and then integrate those learnings across the organization to boost their profitability.
Anup, you have thoughts on that?
Yeah, I totally agree with Ravi. Larger organizations, really with a lot of money they have. And so, for them to get the growth which they need and also to learn from smaller organizations, there is a lot to be done. For us, we are yet very small. So we have not thought about acquisitions. We have to grow our business, and all our money will be behind our products, what we are doing. And for me, acquisitions is not the word right now. We need to focus on our company, our products, and increase our distribution.
Right. Fair enough. We've sort of come to the end of our panel. But before we end, if I can ask each one of you to sort of identify what is the most important criteria that's going to be critical for brands for the next 10 years. Have you thought about the final thoughts, so to speak, on what is it that brands need to take away from this session? Ravi, maybe I can start with you this time.
Yeah, look, it's a very vast question, but I'll say the first thing that is coming to my mind. I think we see ourselves as a challenger brand. Okay, we have challenged the very large players in this existing old industry, and we have been quite successful at it. Yeah. And for the next 10 years, and it's a very interesting question, makes me think, I think what we need to do is to be careful about the new challenges. Yeah. So we have to keep our smarts alive. We have to keep our startup spirit alive. Yeah. Otherwise, there will be new challenges smarter than us who will come and upend us. So I think we want to remain fresh. We want to keep launching new products. We want to keep sticking to our consumers, give them great service, which is essential in consumer durables. Continue to innovate like we have been doing, and faster, and use technology just so that, there will be new players, but we should not be offended by somebody just coming new just because our eyes were closed. So I think we have to keep that spirit alive.
Right. Anup, you have some final
thoughts? Yeah. So I think my thought would be for the young people, wanting to join in business, it's a very committed effort. If you think your product is right and can do well in the market, we have also seen, number of smaller home ventures coming out very successfully. In fact, I've been enjoying breads made out of somebody's house, which I'm really enjoying. In fact, it is better than my bread. And that's a way. I'm learning from that. And it also, for going forward, it is a committed effort, which everyone, whoever wants to join in business, which is very important. Because when my time was there, which was 30 years back, things were very easy.
Right.
Money was available. Money had a cost.
Right.
But it was not so bad as it is today. Today, money is very scarce. We have to spend it wisely. And all what we do, the business should be making profit.
Right.
Business should never lose money, because losing money, you will never get it back. So when you are going to be nimble with the resources, please be careful that you only do that much. Let it be small. Let it grow. I have grown my business in 30 years. Please grow in 30 years. It will be more helpful rather than taking help from large money and, splurging that money out. I just read in a newspaper a company which was valued at 400 crores or 500 crores, a juice company, which went for 100 crores.
Right.
Poor person who made this company, really worked hard, must be at pain. But, it's better to do small efforts and, committed efforts.
Anup, I think it's more painful for the guy who invested 400 crores in that.
I do understand. For him, it is one of the investments. But for the person who built this business, it's his only business.
Yeah.
My heart goes with him.
Yeah. Sanjay, I'll give you the final word. Do you have any thoughts on what is it that brands need to take care of, and what are the most critical? What is going to be the most critical challenge over the next 10 years?
I think obviously the future is not going to be what it is there currently.
Yeah.
And obviously there'll be many pressures, as Mr. Bector and Mr. Saxena have talked about. Mm-hmm. But I think the most critical thing is that brands have to really be in tandem with their consumers.
Mm-hmm.
Because as long as brands are in tandem with the sensible, mm-hmm. needs, but I think more than needs, because mm-hmm. brands appeal to consumers basis two basic vectors. Mm-hmm. One is a functional vector, which is what is the physical need or the functional need of hunger or taste or whatever, or beauty or fairness or whatever, or making beautiful food at home that I am fulfilling. Other is the appealing to the consumer sensibilities and emotions. And I think that going further, the sort of India will become the largest populated country in the world in 2030 or whatever. And our challenges to in that place will be very, very high. We are not even, I think we are not even there in terms of the challenges which we'll see in the next 10 years. So, how do brands become sensible and empathize with their consumers? And I think will be also an important part. And all of that can only happen if brand owners are interacting with their consumers and are actually listening to their consumers. So I think that is very critical. It's always been there for the last 200 years, ever since Unilever launched the Ivory Soap. It will continue for the next 100 years, I think, beyond 10 years. That's
right. All I want to say. Right. Fair enough. Thank you to the panel for a very engaging discussion.